thank you for inviting me. It's a real pleasure for me to be here as well. And the experiment that you mentioned, that had a really, actually doing that experiment, so we started doing that in 2004, 2005, and it had a really profound effect on me. One particular part of it, so it was a web-based experiment. So the experiment was happening through a website, and every morning I would come into the lab and I would check the server to make sure it was still actually running. So like, now obviously all this would be hosted on the cloud and it would be very stable and so on, but here we were running this experiment off the computer on my desk. And one morning I came in and 100 people from Brazil had done the experiment while I was sleeping. I thought, wow, this is amazing. Like, my friends who are in psychology, when they do lab experiments, they have to work like really hard to get 10 people to be in their experiment in a single day. And I just had 100 people participate in my experiment while I was sleeping. That is really cool. And it made me sort of think about like, wow, this digital thing is really different. Like, we can collect data while we're sleeping. And you know, more generally, it turned out that the digital age, I think, has caused us to think differently about the way we go about collecting lots of social science data. So it's not that the data that we're collecting is now completely different, because it was still an experiment, right? The fundamentals of experimental design still apply, but it allows us to put sort of a new spin on some of these timeless ideas from the social sciences. So I'm going to talk a little bit today about my book, Bit by Bit, Social Research in the Digital Age, and this sort of a common theme of this book is exactly what I was just describing, taking traditional ideas from the social sciences and then sort of reimagining how they would work in the digital age. So one way that I think of the book is it's for social scientists that want to do more data science and data scientists that want to do more social science and anyone interested in the hybrid of these two fields. So I personally am a sociologist, but I've spent a decent amount of time with data scientists at some of these institutes at Princeton and also data scientists working at companies, and it's become very clear to me that you have these two really interesting communities that are not really in contact as much as they could be. And I think each community has something to contribute to the other, and each has something to learn from the other as well. And so it's kind of like you have two friends, and you know they would really like each other if they met, so you have a party to get them to know each other. That's sort of how I think about this book. What is a social scientist? I think that part is relatively clear. I do want to say briefly what I mean. How many people here think of themselves as social scientists? How many people think of themselves as data scientists? How many people think of themselves as both? A little bit. All right, good. Okay. So I want to say what I mean here by data scientist, because I don't just mean someone in a hoodie, or, you know, hoodie, like hooded sweatshirt, coding on a laptop. That is not what I mean by data scientist. I don't mean this in the sense of an industrial occupation. I mean it in the sense of a scientist who learns from data. So kind of in the sense of the David Donahoe piece that came out recently, the 50 years of data science. So I would trace this back to statisticians like John Tukey. And so I think of data science as, the way I'm thinking of data science is a big tent that would include things like statistics, and machine learning, and other parts of computer science. So it's meant in a big, inclusive, and positive way, even though some people consider the term sort of derogatory. That's not in any way the way I intend it. So I've been working on this book for about 5 years, and one of the questions that I often get from my colleagues in the hall, maybe very quietly, like, Matt, isn't computational social science just a fad? Like, you're spending all this time on this book, maybe this is just a fad, and maybe you shouldn't be spending this much time on that book. But here I have a very clear answer, and the answer is no, it is not a fad. So the reason why it's not a fad, I guess I probably don't need to convince you all. But I think the best way to think about why it is not a fad is because it's being driven by a fundamental change in the world. Lots of changes in academic interest happened because of changes in academic interest, which was very similar to what my dissertation research was about. But here, this change is really being driven by a change that's happening in the world. So we're transitioning from the analog age to the digital age, that transition is going to happen whether we are a part of it or not. That is driven by much bigger social forces than anything happening at these universities. And so this wave is happening, and we have now the opportunity to take advantage of this and ride this wave, or we could be left behind by this wave. So I think it's actually a great opportunity for us to take advantage of these fundamental changes that are happening in the world to help us do our science better. Now, that does not mean that there are no fad-like elements to what's happening. I think there are certainly fad-like elements. And so the way I like to think about it is with this curve called the hype cycle. So this is a curve that's used by a consulting group called Gartner, and they use this to evaluate new technologies, and they think lots of new technologies go through this entire cycle, and I think this is a helpful way to think about what's happening with computational social science. So the x-axis here is time, the y-axis is visibility. So initially something happens, and then you move to this peak of inflated expectations. So here, many of you have probably heard this big data is going to cure cancer and eliminate poverty and end unrequited love. And then people kind of realize, oh, it's probably not really going to do all that stuff. And then you move into this trough of despair where, oh, the sampling is not good, and there's all kinds of measurement error, and there's algorithmic confounding in the data. And then eventually we can sort of start to figure out how we can work through those problems, and you move to this plateau of productivity where this just becomes a normal part of how we do social science. And so I like to think about what I'm trying to do with the book is push down this peak of inflated expectations, pull up this trough of despair, and then get to this plateau of productivity as quickly as possible. So it's my hope that a lot of what we call computational social science right now will eventually just be called social science. And it's true then there will be something else that's happening 10 years from now at the intersection of whatever digital technologies exist 10 years from now and social science. But the hope is that that stuff will get fed back into what becomes normal social science. If this stuff always becomes, seems to be outside of social science, then I think that's going to cause a lot of problems. So what does this plateau of productivity look like to me as a sociologist? So I think there's a couple important things to keep in mind. One is I don't think we need to change what our goals are. I think this just changes our way of achieving these goals. So if you think about like a doctor and an x-ray machine, the x-ray machine does not change the goals of the doctor. Her goal is still to help you. This is just a new tool that the doctor has to help you. So likewise, our goals as social scientists don't need to change, but our means of achieving those goals have changed. And second, this doesn't displace other methods. So just because a doctor has an x-ray machine does not mean that the doctor would never talk to a patient. Right? That would be a silly, silly thing. So this is just a way of achieving our goals, and it doesn't necessarily displace the methods that we use now. In fact, it's very complementary to a lot of the techniques that social scientists have already developed. Yeah?
Did you know that they took big data off of the hype cycle?
Oh, really? Where is it now?
They just took it off because it's so pervasive in so many trends.
Mm-hmm.
They said, we can't think of it as a thing to describe in terms of hype anymore. And that happened 2 years ago.
Yeah. So big data is itself a very diverse term, as is computational social science. And sometimes people ask me, like, oh, well, what is big data? And so my answer is always, well, it's whatever is cool. And I mean that, though, in a serious way, in the sense that I think if we want this to be successful, so a lot of social movements initially benefit from some ambiguity about what the movement actually is and intends. So an example, in the US, the organic food movement, at the beginning, it was not clear what organic meant, and it meant actually different things to different people, but everyone kind of got behind the idea of organic food, and then only later did it become formalized exactly what you have to do to have organic on the label of your food. And if they had tried to do that earlier in the process, the broad coalition might never have developed. So for strategic reasons, I say whatever is cool. Okay, so I said the book is, again, trying to bring together ideas from social scientists and data scientists together in a way that each community can understand. So in this talk, I want to give sort of one example of a idea that is sort of illustrated throughout the book, and then I'll illustrate that idea a couple of different ways with examples from the research of other scholars. So this is a urinal, but this is a very special urinal. So this you all recognize is Fountain by Duchamp. So this is one of the greatest pieces of modern art, I think. And so what happened is that Duchamp was walking around in New York, he saw this urinal, and he said, here's something that was created for one purpose, but I'm gonna actually use it for a different purpose. So he repurposed this object into a piece of art. And this style of art is called the ready-made, and I think a lot of data science has a very similar flavor. So it takes data that was created for one purpose, usually by a company to help provide a service or make a profit, and then it repurposes this data for research. And so when this repurposing is done well, it's incredible. It changes, like Fountain, it kind of changes what we think is possible and what art is or what social science is. But social scientists will recognize that this is not a very common strategy for social scientists to have used in the past. And we also know that most art is not ready-made. So the strategy that social scientists use is much more similar to a style that's, let's say, Michelangelo used. So when he wanted to create David, he didn't look for a piece of marble that kind of sort of looked like David. He said, no, I'm going to make David, and spent 3 years making David. And so you could think of this style as a custom-made style. And so this is a style that's much more common among social scientists. This is a style that's much more common among data scientists. Neither style is better than the other. So I've heard a lot of conversations about, oh, is Twitter data better than survey data? And I think that's like a not the right way to ask the question. For some problems, survey data is better than Twitter data. For other problems, Twitter data is better than survey data. So it's not that either of these is universally better than the other. It's their different approaches. And I think increasingly what we'll see is we'll see a combination of these strategies. So for social scientists who are used to this pure custom-made strategy, that's going to become harder and harder to ignore all this already existing data. If you're collecting your own data and you're not making use of the huge amounts of already existing data, you're potentially missing a lot of opportunities. And likewise for data scientists, I think they're going to increasingly bring in ideas about data collection because they're going to increasingly realize the limits of these ready-mades. They're not ton of perfect ready-mades in the world, and so you can take a potential kind of sort of ready-made, add some custom collected data, and do something that's cool that you couldn't do with either of these pure strategies. So now I'm going to give, later in the talk, I'll give some examples of research that uses this kind of hybrid approach. So in terms of thinking about structuring the book, there's one question about how one would organize a book like this that will make sense 5 years from now or 10 years from now. So I've been doing this research since 2005 when I was doing my dissertation. I've seen a lot of things come and go during that time. So I've seen like, oh, everyone's really excited about MySpace. And there was a period of time where everyone was really excited about virtual worlds. And this stuff comes and it goes. And so I did not want to write a book that was not going to make sense when it was even printed. If you know how long it takes to get a book printed, like, a lot of stuff can change even in that time period. So I think the key is not to think about specific systems that exist today, but to abstract away, to look for these more timeless elements, things that make sense now and things that will make sense and help us understand the systems that exist in the future. Because we know for sure there will be new systems and new data coming in the future. So how is it that we can sort of get a handle on what is the right abstraction that will make sense now and in the future? And I think this is the classic idea from social science, which is different research designs. So these are roughly ways of organizing research. If you're a social scientist, you've probably learned all of this already, maybe even as an undergraduate. And these are all strategies that have been useful in the past, that are useful now, and I think will be useful in the future. So the first the way I'm trying to organize these research designs, so the first is just observing people's behavior. So we just sit and watch what people do. This is what a lot of big data is now, just observing people's behavior. So to me, as a social scientist, this looks like a particularly weak design, because me as a researcher, I had no role in creating that data, and I know there are limits to what I can learn just by watching what people do. In fact, most social scientists don't use this design now. They use other designs where they play a more active role in creating the data. So if you're willing to do that, if you're willing to interact more with your participants, you can ask them questions. And there are a lot of things that you can learn by asking people questions that you can't learn just by observing their behavior. Then sort of the next step in terms of more active role in shaping how the data is created is running experiments. So here, not only do you interact with the participants, you also randomize them. And finally, we can not just study people, but also involve them in the research process. So this is what I mean by creating mass collaboration. We can move to a system where participants themselves can be an active player in the research process. So one of the things that underlies a lot of these changes, and it's a theme also throughout my book, is that there are a lot of ethical challenges that we will face as we try to do these designs in a new way. So as many social scientists, I think, no one wants to do anything unethical. And if you're doing sort of standard methods in social science, the norms about how these methods should be used are relatively stable and clear now. And so using the sort of traditional offline methods, it's relatively clear what we should and shouldn't be doing. As we move into these things in the digital setting, it's much more common that people run into all kinds of problems. It's been my experience. The ethical questions are much, much harder, in part because researchers now have increasing power over the lives of people. And by power, I mean something relatively specific. I mean, like, we can observe people's behavior without their consent or awareness, and we can enroll them in experiments without their consent or awareness. And if we are collaborating with governments and with companies, we can do this on a massive scale. Like, literally, we can enroll millions of people in an experiment tomorrow if we're collaborating with someone who works at Facebook. So this creates a lot of complicated ethical questions. And so I think increasingly, we as social scientists are going to have to think about ethics as part of our research designs. So there are certain capabilities that we will have that we will have to choose not to use. And so in the past, I think we've been constrained often by what we can do. And I think increasingly, we will be constrained by what we should do. And so then we need to play a bigger role in thinking about what we should do. And so the book has a whole chapter about ethics, but also ethics is intermixed into these other chapters about these different research designs. Just one way that I like to think about it, though, if you could only remember one thing about this, it comes from the Spider-Man. So this is the very end of the first Spider-Man. And Peter Parker, do you have Spider-Man in the UK? Okay, good. Okay. So Peter Parker, his Uncle Ben has just passed away, and he walks into the moonlit sky, and it says, with great power, there must also come great responsibility. So as our power as researchers increases, I think our sense of responsibility also has to increase. And in the book, I try to lay out a way that we can try to do that. So I lay out what I would call a principles-based approach to ethics rather than a rules-based approach to ethics, try to lay out what I think those principles should be and how they should be applied. But that is a separate talk. But I did want to flag this because I think this is going to become an increasingly important part of computational social science. Yeah?
Just a quick question. The well-known bit of research between Facebook and certain Cornell academics,
yep.
Yep. Involved manipulating news feeds according to sentiment.
Mm-hmm.
From your sort of ethics perspective, you know, and where one argument was, well, that is covered by Facebook terms and conditions and didn't need an IRB,
mm-hmm.
and was quite controversial. Would you have a specific perspective from where you're coming from on that particular example?
Yeah, so I talk about that example some in the book. I think one of the things I try to argue for in the book is moving away from thinking about ethics as a dichotomous thing and think of it as more of as a continuous thing. So not to say this was ethical or unethical, but say how could this have been done more ethically or less ethically, right? So I think this switching to a continuous mode helps encourage us to be a little more humble about our claims, because the issues here are complex, and I don't think anyone really knows the right answer about these questions. So if we switch to a continuous, I think that encourages humility. So then, if you are in this continuous setting, so what are some things they could have done differently? I think there are, if we think about the principles, so I advocate for these four different principles, which I didn't make up. These are principles that have been developed by social scientists, ethicists, medical scientists, and computer scientists. So they come from the Belmont Report, which many social, this is all very US-based, I apologize for that. But that's the context that I'm spending most of my time in. So the Belmont Report advocates for three principles, respect for persons, beneficence, and justice. And then the Belmont Report, though, does not do a good job, I think, of handling cases where research is much more embedded in everyday life. And this is part of the challenge of this Facebook study. So in the world imagined by the people in the Belmont Report, there is research as a context, and you know, bring someone into a laboratory on campus or call someone on the phone and ask them a survey question. And so now what we're increasingly seeing is research blended into everyday life. So then the context of the research becomes much harder to understand. Is that a context of research that they're working in? Is it everyday life? How do we think about that? So computer scientists have encountered this problem. Computer scientists working in security have had to do research more in this everyday life setting. So they created another document like the Belmont Report, which is called the Menlo Report. And they added this fourth idea of respect for law and public interest. So these are the four principles that I talk about. And then how would you apply that to the Facebook study? So respect for persons, it would be nice if they let people have some role in deciding whether they should be in the experiment or not. And I think consent ahead of time through an IRB-like procedure is not the only way that, to make this possible. So we can imagine other kinds of systems, and I talk a little bit about that. One I want to talk about a little bit more, though, is beneficence. So this is a sort of trade-off of costs and benefits and who bears those costs and benefits. So here, and this is a role where I think empirical social scientists have a role. So one thing about the emotional contagion study is it was a within subjects design and not a between subjects. It was a between subjects design and not a within subjects design. So basically, they had pre-treatment information about these people and the words that they used, but they actually did not use that in the analysis. They only used the post-treatment information. So that study could have been much more efficient if they had used slightly different methods. And so by doing a richer design, we don't know exactly, but based on other studies using online experiments, we could estimate that they could have cut their sample size in half if they had used some of this pre-treatment information. So there, I think that's like a clear thing that you only want to use the minimum number of people possible that you need, and how do we decide what's the minimum number, and how do we make our experiments more efficient? These are technical things that involve statistics and that we can all sort of agree to work on. That's a principle that I think we can all support, that you want your experiment to be as small as you need to achieve your scientific objectives. And so there's a lot of focus now on how big things are. And I think that from an ethical perspective, we should think, actually, that's not good. Like, we don't want our things to be so big unless that's necessary to achieve our goals. So that's a little bit about that, and I talk much more about that in the book. There's, again, the book is organized around these four main designs. And the title of this talk is Beyond Big Data. So I want to talk much more about these designs and how the tools of the digital age can help us do these designs in new ways. And in fact, this is where actually my own personal work is in this space. So the music experiment that Helen mentioned is here. Some of the work I've been doing about wiki surveys is here. And then a new project I'm working on is here. So I think there's a lot of room in this area. That is not to say there's nothing interesting happening here. I think this space is really cool too. But I think this space is also very exciting, and I hope to convince you of that in this talk. Okay, so asking questions. How can we think about surveys differently? So one of the questions I get often from data scientists is, why should I care about surveys at all? I don't think I need to go into elaborate explanation here, but I will just say briefly, surveys have proven to be a very effective way about learning about the world in the past, and I think that is likely to continue. Now, there's a much longer answer in the book. Then the second question is, why should I care about surveys in the age of big data? This one I will spend a little bit more time talking about, because there's this idea, well, everything is already going to be collected automatically, and we're not going to need that. And I think that's a very, I think that's not the right way to think about it for a couple of reasons. And I think we will continue to need to ask people questions even in the age of big data for a couple of reasons. One is the difference between internal states and external states. So external states are things like behavior, and I think we will ask less about behavior in the future. I think that is true. But there are a lot of things that are interesting to social scientists that are what you would call internal states, things like attitudes, knowledge, beliefs about the future. These kind of things are very hard to learn about from people's behavior, and it's a much easier way to learn about these things by asking people questions. So internal states are important as things social scientists use to explain behavior, and they're also important outcomes in and of themselves. So I think we'll still see that. Then the second is that a lot of big data is fundamentally incomplete. And I mean that in the following sense. Companies don't care about the same things that researchers care about. And so they will often not collect the data that is interesting or important to us. So one example could be my cell phone company. They can tell you what percentage of the calls are going between people who have credit card numbers that end in 9. So this is not a particularly relevant piece of information for us. They cannot tell me what percentage of calls are going between people of different religions or different ethnicities, because they're not collecting data about religion or ethnicity, nor will they likely ever collect that data because they don't want that data, right? That is not data that they want to be anywhere near, right? You can imagine why they don't want to collect that data. So again, I think that you're routinely going to see this kind of incompleteness in big data. And then finally, a lot of the big data is not actually accessible. So an example of this in the US, the National Security Agency is rumored, well, they have this thing called the Utah Data Center, which is in Utah, and it's enormous. And it is rumored to be the case that every email, every phone call, web browsing behavior, credit card records, everything is like in there. So we don't know what's in there, but some people think all that stuff is in there. So that would be a great source of data for social science research. But we are not going to get access to that data. And there are lots of things where companies and governments have data, but they will never, I don't think, give access to researchers for business reasons and for privacy reasons. Like, legitimately, some of this data is very sensitive, and you can imagine that companies don't want to be giving it away to people. So I think this inaccessibility of big data is another reason that we'll continue to need to do surveys even in an age where everything is recorded. So I think we will need to keep asking questions, and how we ask those questions is going to change, though. So this particular study is a great example of, I think, what is possible now. This is a study by Josh Blumenstock about measuring poverty in Rwanda using mobile phone data. And so the problem that he was trying to address is researchers who are interested in development, let's say poverty elimination. One big challenge with that is you actually need to measure how much poverty there is and where it is. And this itself is a hard problem because the governments in these countries are not able to collect the data in the same way that governments in wealthier countries collect it. So in the past, there have been sort of two main ways of collecting this kind of data. One is a census, where you would try to interview everyone. And that is slow and expensive, and there are long time gaps between the data. But censuses are very good for producing granular small area estimates. So you can get estimates by geographic region, or you can get estimates for specific social groups because the census data is so large. So the alternative that social scientists often use to censuses is sample surveys. So those are cheaper and quicker, but they don't give you the same granularity of estimation. So what if you could have some new method that sort of combined low cost and fast with the kind of rich small area estimates you get from a census? Or more general, what if you imagine a world where you have something like a survey where you're asking everyone in the country whatever question you want every day, like this continuous, ubiquitous, always-on survey. So this is not what they actually did, but you could see what they did as a step in that direction. So let me explain to you how the study worked. So they started with call records from the largest cell phone provider in Rwanda. So they had about 1.5 million customers. Every call, who called who, at what time, what was the length of the call, and what was the geographic location of the caller and the receiver. But this data doesn't have information directly about poverty. So what they did is they took a sample of people from these call records, a random sample, and they called them and they gave them a traditional social science survey where they use standard scales that are used to measure poverty in developing countries. So here you have an example of a ready-made data set and a custom-made data set, and then they link them together. So let me explain how this linking happened. So the first thing they did is a step that data scientists tend to call feature engineering. So you take these call records and you turn them into a big matrix where one row is each person and one column is each feature, as a data scientist would say, or variable, as a social scientist would say. And so there's a big challenge in how you do this feature engineering. So you have to have, here it's helpful to have ideas about the particular context. So for example, some of these features could be number of outgoing calls, number of incoming calls, ratio of outgoing to ingoing calls. But then these features could also be things like much more complicated, like number of calls between the people that you call on weekdays, or geographic separation of people that you've called on weekends. Or you can imagine thousands and thousands of these features. And in fact, they created a very high dimensional number of features. Then what they did is they built a machine learning model to predict feature person by feature data to predict the survey data. So here you could imagine doing something like a regression. You have a bunch of features, you have an outcome, which is a continuous measure of poverty, and you build a regression model to do this prediction. Actually, a regression model would not work very well in this setting because they have a huge number of features, so they use something like a lasso, or more of a method with a regularization that's more common in machine learning. So then once you have this model, what you can do is you can use this model to essentially predict everyone else's survey answers. So by asking 1,000 people, you can estimate the answers for the other 1.49 million people. And then the last thing that they did is they also imputed where everyone lived. So roughly what they did is they looked at the center of mass of the cell towers where you make calls at night. It is a little more complicated than that, but if you think about it, where you make calls at night is a good indicator of where you live. So how well did this actually work? So I've described this whole, this may seem like a complicated procedure. How well did it actually work? So there's a couple different ways you could assess it. So the first is what they did is through cross-validation. So essentially what they did is they said, we're going to pretend, we're going to use 90% of the data to train our model, and then we're going to try to test how well we can predict for the other 10% of the data. And then we repeat this process over and over again. And so what you see, here's the predicted wealth here on the x-axis, the actual wealth on the y-axis. You see this is not a perfect relationship, but you see that they are able to do something, right? I don't want to defend the strength of this signal. I want to hold up this study as an example of a structure of research more than I want to talk about the specific results. But in the paper, they go through this assessment in much greater detail. But to me, this is not the most interesting. This is the most common thing in a machine learning paper, but this is not the most interesting thing because we don't care about predicting the wealth in our sample. What we actually care about is Rwanda. We actually care about how well can we predict the geographic distribution of poverty in Rwanda. And so here, they're very lucky that previously there had been a demographic and health survey in Rwanda which measured poverty. And for those of you who are not familiar with the demographic and health surveys, these are very large, well-funded studies by the US government, I think, and maybe other governments, So these are sort of gold standard survey data collection for developing countries. So we can compare now the results from this mobile phone and survey-based approach to the demographic and health survey. We can do that at the regional level because the demographic and health survey produces estimates at the regional level. So this is the average predicted wealth from the call records, and this is from the demographic and health survey. So again, you see there is some signal that's definitely coming from this. And we should also remember the demographic and health data is not perfect either. For those of you who have been involved in these studies, they are good, but they are not perfect. So we have some, clearly this is doing something. So now you may say, okay, so you've created this very complicated machine learning based system to basically do something that we already know how to do. We already have the demographic and health surveys. And in fact, the statistical properties of the demographic and health survey are much more well understood, right? The sampling properties allow theoretical guarantees. There's no theoretical guarantees from this Frankenstein machine learning approach. But the one thing I didn't say, though, is that the approach that comes from the call records is 10 times faster to do and 50 times cheaper. So 50 times cheaper is not 10% cheaper. It's 50 times cheaper. And so that does not mean that we should cut the budget of the demographic and health survey by a factor of 50. I don't think that's what we should do. I think what we should do is collect 50 times more data. So demographic and health surveys happen roughly every 5 years. Many wealthy countries collect important statistical indicators every month. Why shouldn't we do a demographic and health survey basically every month? And if we cut the cost by a factor of 50, we can then dramatically increase the frequency of data collection. So this would be great because we would get much higher frequency. And the second thing that would be really helpful is it would make the process of collecting this data much more open and flexible. So I've actually tried to get questions on the Rwanda demographic and health survey through some of my other work in public health. It's incredibly difficult. Everyone wants to get their questions onto the demographic and health survey because it happens once every 5 years. So what if there was a demographic and health survey happening every month? It'd be much easier for lots of different kinds of researchers to get their questions on there. So I think this is an example here where it's not, the question is not which is better, the call data or the survey data. It's by working together, the call data and the survey data can do stuff that neither of these things could do individually. And the capabilities that you need to do this kind of study involve some traditional social science approaches and some traditional data science approaches. And this can do something that these hybrids can do things that neither pure approach can do. So that's a little bit more about what I think will be an example of the future of survey research. We'll see increasingly surveys linked up to other kinds of big data sets. And I think that is a very promising approach. What time are we supposed to end the talk?
It's now 5 past 6. Mm-hmm. So 10 minutes.
Perfect, okay. So that was the most important study I wanted to tell you about. And what you can do now, if you want to read more about these other things, is you can check out my book. These are flyers for my book. But actually, the book is online now. And I want to tell you actually a little bit about the process of publishing the book. Because this book is about social research in the digital age. But I also wanted this to publish this book in a sort of digital age way. So I'm going to tell you about that process now. Oh, one other thing. This book, it arose out of a class that I've been teaching at Princeton since 2007. And I think this book could be used in other classes as well. And so I've put all my teaching materials from this class on GitHub. And I'm hoping if other people use it in their classes. So for example, it's been used in a class at the University of Chicago. Those professors as well have put their materials online. So I'm hoping that we can get a collection of materials so that other people can learn from how other people are teaching these concepts, and we can all move ahead in how we do teach this material, because there's a lot of students that we want to learn this way of approaching this topic. Okay, so now about actually publishing it. So this is the way books are traditionally published. You have a book, it goes to peer review, 2 people, 3 people maybe read it, you get their feedback, and then you improve it and you have a published book. I actually left out this step of working for 5 years before you get to the book manuscript, but so what I wanted to do is a different process. So simultaneous to peer review, I also wanted to do an open review process where everyone in the world could read the book and help make it better if they wanted or not, but make it possible. So because I know that there's like more ideas out there in the world than there are among the two peer reviewers that Princeton University Press can find to read my book. So I want to do both of these things together and then take the feedback from both of them and turn it into a published book. So this open review process, it's not meant to replace peer review. Peer review has a different role. Open review is meant to complement peer review and allow new sources of input into the publishing process. And so that's what I did. So as soon as I sent the PDF of my book to the press, I created this website where anyone can come and read the book and annotate it here. The annotation is done through an open source system called Hypothesis, which any of you can use for other projects as well. And so anyone can come and read it. Also, we machine translated the book into 100 languages, so people can potentially read it in their native language. This is a sort of, the other thing is that in addition to giving this explicit data about their comments on the book, we're also collecting all the clickstream data about how people are interacting with the book. So we get all this data about how real people are interacting with the book in the wild. So I can get feedback about which parts people are reading, which parts people like, which parts cause people to leave. All this data is available. So here's a map of the visitors. People come from all over to participate. And so sometimes people have asked me, well, what kind of feedback did you get? Like, how did this help? Did this help at all? First of all, did anyone do it? So yes, people did it. Did this help at all? Yes, it definitely helped. So if I had to compare the two processes, the open review and the peer review, the open review comments really helped me write the book I was trying to write. So I would make an argument, and someone would highlight a particular sentence and say, this sentence is confusing, right? Or something like that. Or someone would say, I think you skipped a step here. Or sometimes they would say, here's another study that illustrates this point even better. So you get a range of comments, so this is really trying to help you, whereas I thought the peer review, they were trying to help me write the book they thought I should have written. So the reviewers have their own idea of what the book should be. And now I want to point out that I know that may sound like I'm not saying nice things about the peer review, but there are certain things that the peer reviewers did that pushed the book in a way that the open reviewers did not. So for example, the treatment of causal inference, one of the peer reviewers pushed about, and I was initially kind of grumpy about it. But then I realized that this reviewer was right, and I needed to go back and really rework that part. And that kind of high-level feedback about a big chunk of the book, that doesn't really come very much through the open review. Open review is much more granular about specific topics. So I see these two things as being very complementary to each other, not one is better than the other. Yeah?
Also, you're free to ignore the open review comments.
Yes.
You're not free to ignore the peer review comments.
Exactly. So this is another thing people have asked is like, what if people say stuff that you don't want to do? And say, yeah, just write, thank you. I'm not going to take the book in that direction. That's fine. Yeah?
So was it easy to convince your publisher?
Not easy, but not that hard. And I think part of it was the way that we've designed the system is one that's very sensitive to the needs of publishers. So I think like the next, let's see, how should I express this? Okay, so I think it would be great if academic knowledge was available to everyone in the world. And I think that in journals, we are already seeing a lot of progress on this front. This is certainly not a solved problem, but there's been a lot of great work about journals. and I see hope about journals. And so I think the next place where we're going to see movement towards open access is going to be books. And so I wanted to have a way to make books more open, but then, and publishers do believe in open access. Academic publishers, they want the work accessible, but they want to do it in a way that also allows them to be sustainable. So with this open review process, we try to balance three goals, which is one is improved access, one is higher sales, and one is better books. So the publishers believe in all three of these goals, at least academic publishers do. And if your publisher doesn't believe in those goals, then you could have a different publisher. So the question is, usually we think there's a trade-off between some of these things, and what I've tried to argue and what I've tried to show them, not just argue, but show, is that there's not really a trade-off. That by doing this open review process, we can simultaneously advance all of these. I think if you're having struggles with your publisher about something like this, one thing to keep in mind is the best place to intervene for openness is in the review process, because there is no sales to cannibalize. No one can buy the book now. We're not hurting sales. The book's not even for sale. And by being open during the review process, we can get a much better book. And they're like, okay, yeah, we care about better books. And then the other thing is I was emphasizing in the design of this system how this is going to help us collect data that's going to lead to more sales. So one way to look at this is about making books freely available. If I wear my other hat now, let me just come over here for a second. I can say this is an e-commerce website. So what we're going to do is we're going to monetize all the data that we're and the eyeballs that we're collecting. So this book is free, just like Google is free. Google makes a lot of money by being free because they're not charging you any money, but you are giving Google your eyeballs and you are giving Google your data. And so Google is able to monetize those, and we can monetize those as well. And so that was, I think, the combination of these different messages was sufficient. Also, I worked with them the whole time to do this, and I've shared all the data with them. The last thing is, I did it all. They didn't have to do anything. I said, I'll do it all. You don't have to do anything. And so they were like, okay, well, we'll see. So now I've got a grant from the Sloan Foundation. I've just released open source all the code that we use to do this. So if other authors or publishers or libraries or universities want to do this, it will be much easier because the code is available. And so one thing about the design of the system is it makes it easy to share the data directly with the publishers. And it allows you to, the website is designed in a way that is designed to be a complement and not a substitute for the book. So for example, they're very against posting PDFs, right? And that's a natural thing, but PDFs is also not a good deal for the author because you're not getting the data and you're not able to get the eyeballs in the same way where you can do things like have ads for your book on your website. So I'd be happy to talk much more about this, but if any of you are working on books now, this is available. It's open source. It's totally free. You could hire a developer to do it. You could do it yourself. I also have developers who will do this, who are available to be hired to do this, developers that I would personally recommend who I've worked with in the past. So what I hope we can do is not only we have a book about social research in the digital age, but I hope we can sort of advance publishing in the digital age so that we can make scientific work more available and have better books and have higher sales all at the same time. So that's a little bit about my book. Again, it's trying to bring together ideas from social science and data science, and the open review is still happening. So you can go right now, the book is in copy editing, and so the open review will stay open until the final draft is submitted to the press. So if you'd like to go and read the book and help improve the book, you're welcome to do it. It's at bitbybitbook.com. So thank you very much.
It can take a few minutes.
That would be great.
We're only taking them off the drinking times.
So. Oh. Yeah?
I was
just want to talk about the technical trajectory of social scientists,
mm-hmm.
and whether there's a what we expect out of people that we will mold into these sort of interdisciplinary scholars. What do we do about people whose skills are not up to scratch for some types of things? Where do they fit into projects? What else can they do if they're not going to be great statisticians in addition to being great survey research persons?
Yeah, it's a big challenge. So I think what we can do is change how we teach. So like we're doing this at Princeton. Like part of it is we can offer courses in computational social science, but also what we can do is bring these ideas into already existing courses. So for example, some colleagues and I have been rethinking our PhD program and our undergraduate program all have required courses in statistics. So what does it mean to teach a statistics class in 2017? Like, should they be looking up Z values in the back of the book in a physical table? No, they shouldn't, right? That doesn't make sense anymore. That may have made sense in the past. It doesn't make sense anymore today. So we can change the way we teach statistics. And so what we're trying to do at both the undergraduate and graduate level is bring in more coding, bring in more data science, bring in working with more real data. And so I think through processes like that, we can get a lot of these skills baked into what it means to be a social scientist, not just what it means to be a computational social scientist. Yeah, and then?
Can you give a brief example of what you mean with mass collaboration as one application of big data?
Sure. So I think one sort of actually, the work by some of your colleagues, so I would say in the mass collaboration section, there's very few examples from social science, because this method is not yet common in social science. But I think one example of really exciting mass collaboration comes from researchers here at Oxford. Chris Lintott and some of his colleagues who do the Galaxy Zoo project and then the Zoo Universe project. So what they try to do is bring more people, citizen science is another term for this. So they try to bring more people into the scientific process. So right now they take certain tasks. The first one was about classifying galaxies. So it turns out that to classify galaxies as being spiral, or I'm not an astronomer, so I'm doing my best to summarize this project. So there are spiral galaxies and there are elliptical galaxies. And so they wanted to study certain things about the properties of these galaxies. It turns out it's hard to do this algorithmically, or at the time it was hard to do it algorithmically, but it was relatively easy for a human to do it. So astronomy graduate student, I believe his name is Kevin Chwansky, he tried to do this himself, and he was able to classify something like 50,000 galaxies in one like never-ending week of work. But there was this thing called the Sloan Digital Sky Survey, which was happening around that time. And they were essentially taking a big data approach to astronomy. They took pictures of a million galaxies. So it's like, if you want to classify a million galaxies, you can't just have one graduate student doing it. And they knew that now one of the first Sloan Digital Sky Surveys. Now they have pictures of billions of galaxies, or trillions, or whatever it is now. So you need some kind of different approach. So one thing that because this is relatively easy for people to do with relatively limited training, they put it up online and they said, come and volunteer and help us classify these galaxies. And so people would come to the website, they would have a 5-minute training session, and then they would start working. Now you might think that's going to be terrible data. If you've ever like worked with undergraduate research assistants, you would like giving them 5 minutes of training and then letting them loose sounds like a terrible idea. And these are not even undergraduate students at Oxford. These are just anyone on the web could come and do this. So what the people, I guess, lacked in specific training and filtering, they replaced with redundancy. So they had something like 40 labels per galaxy. And so they're able to then combine all of these labels to get very strong consensus labels of these galaxies. And then also, this scale, though, deals with the problem of random error. It doesn't deal with the problem of systematic error. So one of the things they did that was very clever is there were certain very systematic biases they were worried about. I think far away elliptical galaxies look like spiral galaxies, or maybe it was the other way around. So they built in these kind of quality control checks into their system to detect these systematic biases, and they were able to correct for them as well. And so I think there are lots of projects where you have the limiting factor is really the scale of the thing. It's like if you have a thing where you say, if I had 1,000 research assistants, I could do this. That's the kind of thing that could potentially be turned over to mass collaboration. We take one big problem, split it up into lots of little problems, have people work on those little problems, and then combine the results from all these little problems. So those of you who do like parallel computing, this sound might sound like MapReduce, right? It has a very similar structure. So I think that is one example. That's from astronomy. But there are other examples in the book. And
I have a question. So in physics, there's an idea of determinism. So if you know all of the particles in this room, you can predict the future. Do you kind of see a similar trend in social science and the sort of effect of sort of gathering all this data and understanding of people? Is there going to sort of be a sort of singularity of information and technology?
I'm not worried about that for the short term or the medium term for that matter. I do think what's very exciting is that as the size of our data increases in two ways, in terms of the number of people and the amount of information per person, I think we can begin to see better how well we can actually predict things at the individual level. So right now, social science, there's sort of two statistical modeling cultures. This is beautifully explained in a paper by Leo Braman. So one is the style in machine learning and data science where they focus more on the y hats. And then in social science, we tend to focus more on the beta hats, right? And so you have these two styles. And I think social scientists, for example, you very rarely see them talk about how well their model predicts or the R squared of their model. We never even talk about it, usually because they're so low that we don't even want to mention it. So I think that increasingly, we're going to see improvements in our ability to do the y-hat stuff because we have more data, so we can have more variables in the model, we can have more, because we have more people, we can have more flexible functional forms. And so I think we're going to really start to see empirically to what extent we're going to encounter this, but I think we will see big changes in our ability to predict individual level outcomes as we have more data and more about each person.
What's your take on the interplay between statistical models and mathematical computational models to model computational social science? Because in economics, for instance, they always say that you will never be able to predict that never tried policies on existing data because it's a new policy, so you need their model.
Yeah, so I think I would think of them as being complementary and not in competition. So it's true, if you are trying to predict the outcome of some policy process, that policy has never been done before, there has to be some form of extrapolation in some way. And so if I was forced to do some kind of extrapolation like that, then I would want to do it a variety of different ways and see how consistent the results were. And so computational approach is one approach, and you could also try running experiments in small regions, and there's a number of things you could try. But I think there's no reason to see these things as it being in conflict, because when the challenge of what we're trying to do is very hard, it's best to try to do it multiple ways.
Just a quick question. What is not in the book?
What is not in the book? A lot is not in the book. So one thing is there are basically no equations. And the reason for that is because there are already really great books about machine learning. There are great books about sampling. There are great books about experimental design. There are great books about coding. There are great books about databases, and so on and so on and so on. So the way I try to think about my book is trying to do something that these is a bridge into these other things. So I think it's a bridge for social science into ideas from data science. It's a bridge from data science into ideas from social science. And then it's a bridge for all this into this other more technical literature. So at the end of each chapter, I have pretty long sections called What to Read Next, where I go through and I say, okay, if you really like this idea about heterogeneity of treatment effects, here are some papers about heterogeneity of treatment effects that I think are interesting. And so that's kind of, there's a lot that's not in the book. But what I tried to do is help link people to that other stuff. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm quite intrigued because I've got a book proposal that went out to review today,
actually. Ah, okay.
So you knew that you were going to put this out to open review.
Yes.
Did that change how you approach writing the first draft?
That's a good question. No. Well, a little bit, actually. So to me, it made me... I struggle a lot with like calling something finished. And so to me, the idea of having a book and calling it finished is incredibly scary because it kind of feels very permanent. And so the idea that it was going to get this much wider set of eyes on it made me feel more comfortable saying, okay, like this is like ready enough for this next stage of visibility. So to me, it would be very scary to write the whole book basically in private and then move it into the world completely in public. That would be very scary for me personally. So I like that it has this kind of intermediate step. So I work on it in private, then I move to this kind of intermediate. It's public, but it's still very clearly a draft. Its label is the open review edition. So I get this feedback, and then I can improve it, and then move it into the fully public phase. So I felt like it made it easier for me psychologically.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
I was wondering, you talked about mobile phone analysis,
mm-hmm.
I guess research project,
mm-hmm.
Where they used maybe one, two, or three data sets,
mm-hmm.
to do this prediction.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know of any really good examples where someone's tried to predict singular outcome from like hundreds of data sets?
Oh, no, but I think that's very interesting. So I think in the same way that this study combined one sort of big data set, administrative record data set, and one survey, I think increasingly we're going to start to see lots of data sets combined and potentially using many data sets to try to do exactly what you described. And I don't have any great examples of that. I'm sure there are some. If you know some, please let us both know. But I think that's a very exciting area because we're having more and more data sets. Each of these data sets has different strengths and weaknesses. And so to the extent that we can, rather than picking one data set and saying, okay, this is our best guess, if we could do like 100 data sets and they all yield the same answer or similar answer, we could be like, okay, that's great. And if they all yield very different answers, then we could be more cautious. So I think it's a very promising direction. I think we'll see much more of that in the future. Yeah, or we should have moved to drinks?
Well, would it be possible for people to ask their questions kind of en masse?
Whatever you would like, Helen. So do you want to both ask your questions, and all of you?
Coming back to that study, so the study of using the secondary phone data for,
mm-hmm.
for looking at inequality,
mm-hmm.
Because we have a project going here with OII on big data development, we thought was really interesting as well. One of the things I wonder about,
mm-hmm.
is a bit like the, and I'm wondering if there's an analogy to the Google Food Trends story there.
Yes.
So we look at a particular time and we see this fantastic way that we can utilize the secondary mobile phone data, which gets rid of all of these really expensive ways we've traditionally captured data about income inequalities and so on. And we know it holds now, but how do we know it holds tomorrow, and how will we
yep.
know when it stops holding?
I think that's a great question. Can I answer that? All right, we'll collect all the questions, and then I will answer that, but I think that is a great question, and I've thought a lot about that one. Yep.
So you talked a little bit about ethics and being able to combine data sets.
Mm-hmm.
I was just wondering what your thoughts were on firms like Cambridge Analytica.
Yep. Okay. Those are both good questions.
Then
we'll talk more at drinks.
Then we go to drinks.
It would be great. I'd love to have a drink now while I answer these. So first is about, I would say one way of expressing it is the temporal stability of the Rwanda study. For those of you, like Google Flu Trends is a great example where you have a predictive model that works well and then stops working. So the question is, for a lot of these things that are based on these kinds of empirically observed patterns, to what extent that we, can we be confident they'll hold in the future or in other settings, right? You could imagine you want to do this in Uganda. Uganda is socially different than Rwanda. You may get a different result. So I think the way to address this problem is to continually do this kind of training and testing repeatedly. So one of the things that happened with Google Flu Trends is they sort of seemed to stop calibrating the model, and then there was drift, and then they had problems. So I think we definitely need to continually calibrate these because society changes. Also, the way these firms work changes. So Google, for example, part of the reason Google Flu Trends changed, we think, we don't really know, is that Google changed the way their search algorithm worked. So it's likely, like this phone company in Rwanda, they could have a new sale where they give you free international calls on the weekend, let's say. Or maybe they only do that for some people. Or there's all kinds of things that they could do which would cause people to change their behavior, which would then mess up the results of this model that were trained on old behavior. So I think we'll need to continue to refit. And then the longer term thing, though, is that we should think about how do we provide more theoretical guarantees about these kinds of procedures. So one of the great things about sampling is that we can put confidence intervals, you know, under idealized conditions, we know something about the sample-to-sample variability. We can have these theoretical guarantees. To what extent are some of these new methods, are we able to develop theoretical guarantees about how to think about exactly the kinds of biases that you describe? And then the second question was about Cambridge Analytica. Or more generally, we could think about all kinds of data-driven campaigning or large-scale data collection by companies that's used in a variety of ways that people don't understand or certainly don't consent to. So I hope that companies will increasingly adopt ethical codes in some of the ways that social scientists have done. So we've sort of, and medical scientists, and I hope that they will start to bring, companies will start to bring some of this inside of the companies so that they will think more about the ethics of what they're doing. That may not happen. You may think that that's crazy, that the companies would never do this. But I do think it's potentially possible if there's a strong pushback from society and also from government. So a lot of these companies are potentially fear regulators. So to the extent that there's pressure from civic society and governments, it may be possible for these companies to adopt certain practices or conventions that they won't do certain things. I think we have to hope that that happens because, again, increasing amounts of data and capabilities. I think it's not just Cambridge Analytica right now that has me concerned, but like, what is that company or the next company going to look like 10 years from now or 20 years from now when these capabilities are even more enriched? And so I think that if computational social scientists increasingly think about ethics and bake that into what we do and how we talk about things, that will then spill over some into these companies.
Well, thanks very much.
Yeah.
That was absolutely brilliant. I hope we will contribute to your book. Please tell me how we're doing that time.